Hello and welcome back to the Parkinson's Disease Education Podcast. Parkinson's treatments typically revolve around either replacing dopamine or helping protecting the dopamine-producing neurons in the brain. But what if a decades-old antiparasitic drug could actually tweak brain circuits and make levodopa work even better? Recent animal studies have shown that exact possibility for ivermectin, which is an antiparasitic. Today, we're going to basically separate theory from reality. What experiments actually are showing about ivermectin, why the blood-brain barrier and safety matter in this instance, and whether any of it could even potentially reach patients at some point in the future. I'll give you a hint. It's interesting, but it's far from proven at this point in time. With that said, I'm going to roll the intro, and I'll see you on the other side as we dive into ivermectin as a potential treatment for Parkinson's disease. Let's go. Welcome to the Parkinson's Disease Education Show, where we demystify the disease and empower you as the person with Parkinson's disease to reach your true potential. The content contained on this show is for informational purposes only and is not meant to be a replacement for information or advice that you receive from your in-person medical or therapy professionals. If you haven't already, I hope you'll consider subscribing, and for an even more personalized experience, please ask us about our memberships. Now, without further ado, let's start the show. Now, before we go any further in the episode, I do want to slow down and clearly explain what we mean and what we don't mean when we say that ivermectin might help in Parkinson's disease. As I mentioned in the intro, ivermectin has been used for decades as an antiparasitic in both animals and in humans. Ivermectin has a long history of being safe and effective for those specific types of treatments. Parkinson's disease, of course, is not a parasitic situation. So the obvious question is, why is ivermectin even being discussed at all in the potential treatment for Parkinson's disease? It's a fair question. To best answer that question, we need to dive into some existing lab research in neuroscience versus clinical evidence that's existing currently. So in recent years, neuroscientists have been doing research in a specific area of the brain called the striatum or the striatum. And that is actually where the dopaminergic neurons are located, including the substantia nigra, pars compacta. That's the part of the brain that is impacted directly by Parkinson's disease. So while dopamine is the primary issue with Parkinson's disease or production of dopamine does not stand alone as the only neurotransmitter affected by Parkinson's disease. In fact, in the striatum, there are other neurotransmitters produced, including acetylcholine. So changes in acetylcholine, dopamine, etc., all affect movement and motor fluctuations. It also affects how effective medications like levodopa can be once introduced into the brain. So the only reason ivermectin ever came up as a possibility of having anything to do with Parkinson's is because of its effect on interacting with certain receptors in the brain, and we're going to break that down next. Specifically, in terms of receptors in the brain, ivermectin is known to interact positively with P2X4 receptors as well as nicotinic acetylcholine receptors. In terms of how ivermectin interacts with those receptors, it's termed in scientific terms a positive allosteric modulator. I'm going to explain what that means next. So as a modulator, ivermectin does not turn those receptors on specifically, but it does make them respond more positively or strongly to the natural signals that they receive from the neurotransmitters involved, like dopamine, acetylcholine, etc. Why that matters is that the P2X4 receptor and nicotinic acetylcholine receptors, they do specifically affect regulation of cholinergic signaling in the striatum. Cholinergic neurons help directly to control dopamine release. At this point, it's been shown in animal models and in brain slice experiments that ivermectin appears to enhance cholinergic activity, which could indirectly induce or increase dopamine release. That could also include dopamine released with stimulation by levodopa. In fact, in some rodent studies, the results actually showed stronger or more consistent motor responses when levodopa was present in those that were taking ivermectin. That is actually the reason why this has even entered into conversation in terms of human research. But, and there's a big but here, the critical distinction we need to make is that the findings that we're talking about today in this episode are preclinical. meaning at this point, only animal studies have shown any sort of promise biologically that this is even a possibility in humans. So at best, the preclinical research that we're talking about today asks the question, is there a biological mechanism here worth paying attention to or worth searching into more? It does not, however, answer the question of whether people should take ivermectin or not. So another problem we need to discuss with ivermectin is the fact that it doesn't easily cross the blood-brain barrier, specifically because of P-glycoprotein. That's a protein that is meant to pump things out of the nervous system that we don't want in the nervous system. And this is a really good reason why our brain and neural tissue is protected from certain things crossing that barrier, because it's a very sensitive tissue. And as we know, it doesn't often heal or come back after damage or death. So when ivermectin does cross into the human brain at higher levels, either due to overdose, drug interaction, or something along those lines, there have been neurological side effects reported, and that's important to note. That can include symptoms like confusion, impaired coordination, seizure, and altered levels of consciousness. So in short, ivermectin being at levels high enough to cross the blood-brain barrier may raise serious safety concerns. That leads us into the next point, that currently there are no well-designed clinical trials showing that ivermectin actually can improve Parkinson's symptoms, slow disease progression, or that it's even safe to make a change like that. None. There is no study out there that exists at this point in time. That does not, however, mean that this research is useless. It just means we aren't at a point yet where we can safely move forward with studies on this. Now, while ivermectin may not directly be a treatment for Parkinson's, it can be used in this context as a research tool rather than treatment. In other words, if it helps scientists better understand how cholinergic and dopaminergic systems can interact in Parkinson's disease, that could be a win as well for treatment. We know, for example, that dopamine levels affect acetylcholine production, and it seems like cholinergic system stimulation also basically has a similar relationship with dopamine production. So further studying that is of value. So all this to say, if you see claims that ivermectin is some hidden or suppressed cure for Parkinson's, just simply, there is no evidence for that. That's the bottom line. What we can say in this episode is that Parkinson's disease involves complex dysfunctions of the circuitry in the striatum and other areas between some of these different neurotransmitters, receptors, different neurotransmitter production. And if we can learn more how to improve those circuits and how they work together, that could help manage symptoms even more effectively than we do now. So for now, it's still in early stage preclinical research, and it remains firmly in that category. And moving forward, discussion of ivermectin, it should be done carefully, with responsibility, and without hype, because we're just not in a position to say that this is a viable treatment. So to conclude, we'll see where the research goes with this. I personally don't feel like there's a whole lot to this, but I could be wrong. And I hope I am, because if it does mean there's some kind of improvement in treatment, that's important. But I just want to say as a disclaimer, please do not self-medicate with ivermectin thinking this is something that's just going to turn things around. It is primarily for parasites, not for brain disorders. You don't know what you could be doing by taking high levels of ivermectin. And human efficacy and safe dosing for Parkinson's have not been established. What we do know that it's safe for, and it's a longstanding, has a longstanding safety record for, is for dealing directly with parasites. And that includes animals and humans. I'm gonna drop links below in the description to a couple of articles that are kind of tying in what we discussed in this video in terms of the preclinical studies that have been done. One of them is only about a year old, so it's pretty relevant information. And I hope that you enjoy reading that and looking into it. Otherwise, I'm going to wrap up this episode. I want to thank you all for watching and listening. I look forward to seeing you in the next episode. Until the next episode, I hope you're well. Be empowered. Catch you next time.